This is a list of future NFL receivers that J.C. Horn had to cover while he was in college. And this isn't even a complete list, these are just the ones that I felt compelled to mention. I had to write it down because there's so many. The list goes like this: A.J. Brown, Kyle Pitts, Devonta Smith, Jalen Waddle, Jerry Jeudy, Henry Ruggs, Elijah Moore, De'Ami Brown, Justin Ross, Cordell Powell, Josh Palmer, Trevin Grimes, Van Jefferson, Tyree Cleveland, Seth Williams, and Terrace Marshall Jr. Two things stick out to me about that list. Number one, it's incredible that Horn survived that gauntlet in the first place, because that's basically your average NFL schedule of receivers, except JC had to cover them as a 19-year-old in the SEC. And number two, whoever's recruiting receivers for Alabama deserves a massive raise, because what the fuck?
Ça va, ça vient, ça vit ici. Je suis de là, de l'eau, de l'air. J'attends paisible et cible placide. Les années merveilles avec des rayons de soleil. Je suis issu d'Ilysse, déçu d'attendre la chance avec ses couettes et son cœur tendre. Mais on n'a rien sans rien, sérieux? 100 ans ne ferait pas s'entendre, moi et moi. C'est con comme quoi, faut bosser pour exister, persister, insister, inciser ses regrets, ses peurs, ses doutes. Ça va, ça vient, ça glisse, ça tombe, ça sombre, ça se lève. Ça va, ça vit, ça va, ça vient. Ça va et ça vient. Ça va, ça va.
J.C. Horn is, to me at least, the best defensive back in this class. Which I know isn't a super crazy thing to say, because I know a lot of people out there would agree with that. I mean, you can put him in press, you can put him in off, you can put him in the slot or outside, zone or man, it doesn't even matter. He's good at everything. Not to mention that he's also a historically ridiculous athlete with really long arms, which obviously helps as well. Just overall, he is the one corner in this class that I don't think has any true weaknesses, which is why I've given him the highest grade I've handed out to any DB since Jalen Ramsey came out 6 years ago. However, perhaps even more impressive than his skill set is, as I said before, the sheer number of future NFL receivers that he's covered and played well against in college. I truly believe that the experience he's gotten while taking on that challenge is going to be one of his biggest reasons for success at the next level. And don't get me wrong, all of these super talented receivers did take their pound of flesh from Horn every now and then, as you might expect. Cough, cough, Devonta Smith. But the lessons that Horn has learned from all of his losses have, in my opinion, made him a better corner prospect today. Let's go back to that Alabama game in 2019, which undoubtedly was the hardest assignment he ever took on in his college career, having to cover four future first-round picks, all of them likely top 15 picks at that. And all things considered, Horn, who was still a sophomore at that point, did a somewhat decent job. He had two pass breakups on 8 targets, though he still did give up 5 catches for 113 yards and a very long touchdown to Smith, so there was a little bit of good mixed in with plenty of bad there. But to me, the main lessons that he learned from getting picked on in that game is that the Bama receivers took advantage of his tendency back then to not use his hands to feel routes develop, and even on the rare occasions when he was making contact with his hands, he would play on what's known as the low shoulder position a lot when in man coverage, which left him vulnerable to a few specific routes that Alabama exploited over and over again. Hand usage is a criminally underrated trait for corners, especially when facing very shifty receivers like all of the Bama guys. Footwork and hip fluidity and obviously raw speed are all important too, but if you're in a press alignment and you don't use your hands to disrupt a receiver, or at least to feel a route develop, then you're completely at the mercy of that receiver's own agility and you probably have no shot of actually sticking with them in the first place. That lack of hand usage was a big problem for Horn as a sophomore when facing legit NFL talent, because he couldn't feel their breaks, he couldn't feel their route pacing or the subtle shifts in their body weight through that contact, and as a result, he could not stay with them step for step. Plus, beyond that, even when he was using his hands in coverage, as I said, he would mostly either be even with the receiver when in phase, or he would cover them from that aforementioned low shoulder position. And when I say low shoulder, by the way, what I mean is that he's getting into the receiver's hip pocket while being slightly behind the receiver's shoulder, That is the low shoulder spot, as some DB coaches refer to it. And you're basically leveraged underneath the receiver field position wise. The high shoulder, conversely, is when the DB is positioned slightly over the top of the receiver, with their leverage being in front of that shoulder. Some coaches will call that a soft stack technique, or playing the route from the top down. Now, there's nothing inherently bad about positioning on either the low shoulder or the high shoulder when in man coverage. Both techniques have their own advantages and disadvantages depending on the style of defense they're in, but Horn specifically struggled against Devonta Smith from that low shoulder spot because Smith is just too damn slippery to reliably stay in his hip pocket from that trailing position. I'll give you an example. This is an incompletion from the first quarter of that game, but it was still a lost rep for Horn in man coverage because of some rather poor hand placement while he was in phase from the low shoulder. Smith is just running a pretty basic curl route here against press, and after a really good release at the line of scrimmage where he gets nice and wide to the inside, and after Smith gets low with that upfield shoulder so that he presents as small a target as possible for Horn to grab onto, Devonta starts to stack on Horn and sell like he's running a vertical route here. Horn missed Smith at the line with his inside hand because, well, he's Devonta Smith, he's slippery as hell, but JC does recover nicely and gets into that low shoulder position right on Smith's hip pocket pretty quickly into the route regardless. That's all of that amazing athleticism from Horn showing up on tape for him to immediately get back in phase like that. However, despite those obvious physical gifts, here is where Horn made his mistake with his hand usage that ultimately caused him to still lose on this rep anyway, and I'll switch to the end zone angle here so that you can see it a little bit better. As Horn is recovering from the release and getting back in phase, look at where his right hand is. It's up high, right on the back of Smith's shoulder pad, which is way too high, especially for a guy like Smith who gets really low when he breaks down on a cut. And as you can see here, when Smith sank his hips into the break on this curl, he just slipped right under Horn's hand and easily got loose to work back to the ball while JC kept flying further down the field. Honestly, Horn should have had his hand lower on Smith, just under the shoulder blade or in the mid-back, so that he could feel that curl coming and break down with it, not after it. Because if his hand goes any higher than that, with how, for lack of a better word, bendy Smith is as a route runner, he would just slip out of position like he does here. This particular technical mistake happened multiple times with Horn throughout that Bama game because, quite frankly, he didn't know any better yet about proper hand placement. He didn't have any prior experience against receivers that knew how to punish bad hands by sinking super low, breaking contact, and separating that quickly. The polish in route running that he faced that day was a totally new thing for him to see, and it's something that you honestly can't prepare for until you play against it. But trust me, he did learn from it, and he did significantly change his playstyle after he got torched in that game, which is what excites me so much about him as a prospect to begin with, that ability to change and adapt when he gets beat. But I'll get to specifically what he adjusted in his technique to compensate a little bit later. For now, before we get into all that, I want to touch on his other main issue in that Alabama game that he had to improve on for the next year, which is that he kept violating the golden rule of being a press man corner: secure the route and then worry about securing the ball. Not the other way around. Too many times, when positioned on the low shoulder, and especially when he thought he had help inside or help from over the top from a post safety, he would take a peek at the quarterback before actually securing the route. And again, because his hand placement and contact wasn't really all that good at this point, without eyes on the receiver, he would lose track of them and they would just slip right behind him with no resistance. That was the exact mistake that Horn made on the 40 plus yard touchdown he gave up to Smith, and he damn near gave up another one to Judy later in the game as well on that exact same error. It was a really bad, bad habit for him back then. And to me, that eye discipline issue was mostly a symptom of his over-aggression against equally gifted opponents. He's so athletic and so competitive against top competition that he's always hunting for an opportunity to undercut a route and get a turnover, but sometimes, again, at least back in his sophomore year, against receivers that knew how to punish him, that aggression would bite him in the ass instead of actually helping him. But again, as a junior, you could really tell that he learned from those mistakes from the year before, and he definitely reined in that lack of discipline and became much more under control. In 2020, you almost always saw him place a premium on securing routes first and never turning his head until he knew for sure that he was in phase. And that discipline, that focus to always stay within arm's reach of a receiver even when the route broke down and became a scramble drill, that newfound attention to detail is why he went from giving up a catch once every 17 coverage snaps as a sophomore to giving up a catch once every 30 coverage snaps as a junior, nearly doubling his efficiency overall. Now, you might be wondering then, what were the technical changes that he made in the 2020 season after Alabama roasted him the year before? What did he do so differently to improve that much? And the answer, to put it simply, is that he decided to go all in on physicality. Last season, Horn started to play man coverage primarily from a high shoulder position, not the low shoulder, and rather than pressing at the line, he would usually start a play by doing what's called soft shoeing a receiver's release so that he could stack on routes from the top down very easily and really disrupt those routes after receivers released in whatever direction they were trying to go. He would try to maintain contact with both hands for as long as possible, one in the chest and one on the back, all while still taking advantage of his incredible speed, fluidity, and balance to stay in phase the entire way while he was beating up these receivers down the field. It was a very Richard Sherman, Jalen Ramsey, Stephon Gilmore-ish style of play that we didn't get to see too much of from him in 2019. But again, in his last year in college, he really amped up the physicality and played the position like an actual elite NFL corner would. In particular, on routes down the boundary, you would really see his growth and evolution in his playstyle show up. Against an outside release from Devonta Smith, for instance, back in 2019, you saw the old J.C. Horn try to jam him at the line and then slide into his hip pocket with his back still turned to the quarterback, which of course then led to his issues with hand placement and giving up easy curls and timing routes and stuff like that. But in 2020 now, you started to see Horn play those same outside releases differently. Now he would use a soft shoe technique to just mirror the receiver's release from over the top with his eyes on the receiver's hips, rather than just trying to jam him. And then once the receiver declared what direction he was going to go, which in this case was outside towards the boundary, Horn would use his length and athleticism to get into a stack position over the top, with both hands making contact, of course, in order to completely prevent that receiver from getting vertical on him. Plus, from that stack technique, Horn could peek a glance at the quarterback while securing the route to keep an eye out for curls or anything that would break to the inside late, which would give him a better chance of stopping those kinds of routes as well. In the Auburn game, for instance, you can see him get an interception and a huge return while executing these techniques to perfection. Horn again soft-shoed the outside release to mirror it over the top. He jammed the receiver and got into a hard stack position, shutting down any vertical route, obviously. And then once the route was secured, he got his eyes on the backfield to look for any curls that would break back underneath him, which, coincidentally, the quarterback was actually trying to throw here. Because Horn's head was turned around so early, he was able to locate this ball before even the receiver did, and he broke on it to get a huge interception and a bunch of return yards. This change in technique from playing underneath receivers and constantly trying to undercut them to playing an overwhelmingly physical style from over the top was subtle, but it made all the difference in the world to Horn's effectiveness on the field, and he became a much better player after switching things up. And truth be told, I don't think he would have changed and became this kind of corner if he had not gotten his ass kicked by Alabama the year before. That game was the ultimate learning experience because it gave him a preview of what to expect in the NFL, and those losses ultimately helped him when he had to face even more future NFL receivers the very next season. Whether he was going toe-to-toe with Kyle Pitts on the outside, or covering the super speedy Elijah Moore in the slot, or dominating Seth Williams on jump balls, Horn did anything and everything you could ever ask from a corner, and as a junior, he did them all at an exceptionally high level. It's one thing as a prospect to be big and technically sound and freakishly athletic and super smart and instinctive and all that, but on top of that incredibly high floor as a player, to also demonstrate the ability to improve and at least little by little get closer to your ceiling, that's what really makes me love J.C. Horn. It's that work ethic to learn from mistakes and develop, because in the end, that's all we can really ask for from young players in the NFL. Just work hard and get a little bit better each and every day. J.C. Horn fits that bill of someone who's coming into the league with an exceptionally high floor, but who also potentially has an astronomically, historically high ceiling. He is the best I've seen since Jalen Ramsey, straight up. He is that good. But unlike Jalen, he does have one unique advantage that almost no other corner ever has. And that advantage is this list of names. This list is his body of work. It's his resume. And at least compared to 99% of every college corner ever, this resume is as good as it gets. He's talented, he's battle-tested, and he's pro-ready. If that doesn't sound like a top 10 pick to you, then I don't know what is. Now, I'll be back early next week with the start of the content that you've all been waiting for the last 2 months. Of course, the annual position ranking specials for offense and defense, and of course, the annual mock draft special. So, I'll see you all back here next week, and until then, cheers. Thank you so much for watching this week's episode, and again, thank you to our sponsor for this week, HelloFresh. If you've watched this channel for a while now, you know that the other love of my life besides football is cooking, and with HelloFresh, I finally have something that lets me cook a huge variety of delicious meals without ever needing to leave my house to go grocery shopping. Every single delivery gives us something new that we've never tried before, and every meal that we've had from HelloFresh has been incredibly delicious. This month, they sent me the recipes and ingredients to make white cheddar burgers and Old Bay fries, Tex-Mex pork and pepper enchiladas, and my personal favorite, buffalo crispy chicken cutlets. All of the ingredients were fresh, they were perfectly portioned out, and in my opinion, the final products tasted just as good as if I got the same thing at a restaurant, but just way, way cheaper. HelloFresh makes it easy to make all of their recipes too, just by following the instructions, even if you're relatively new to cooking and you don't have a big, fully loaded kitchen. And also keep in mind that there are tons of other chef-curated recipes for you to choose from every single week on HelloFresh, even low-calorie, vegetarian, and pescatarian options. And on average, HelloFresh customers save 28% in cost compared to going to their local grocery store to buy the same ingredients to make the very same meals. Plus, because each meal is portioned out perfectly, you're not buying a bunch of extra food that ends up going to waste either, so HelloFresh is more sustainable as well. For someone like me that works 60 plus hours a week between Sundays and Fridays on most weeks, especially now during draft season, HelloFresh has been a great way to still eat good food without spending a lot of time or money that I just don't have. So, if you want to try it out for yourself just to get a taste of how convenient and easy it can make your life, please check them out at HelloFresh.com at the link in the description below. Use my code FILMROOM12 and get a total of 12 free meals, including free shipping. Again, that is HelloFresh.com at the link below, promo code FILMROOM12 for 12 free meals, including free shipping.